Well, good morning to each one of you. I'm very thankful to be here, and our topic this morning is making a U-turn. But before I talk about making a U-turn, I want to just broach a subject very quickly that we began talking about in prayer meeting Wednesday night. Do you remember what we talked about in prayer meeting Wednesday night, anybody? We were talking about the judgment of the great harlot as depicted in Revelation 17. And especially since the 11th of February, the morning that Pope Benedict the 16th announced that he was going to resign, a lot of ideas have been circulating and making the rounds on the internet and different circles concerning prophecy and what does all this mean? What is the prophetic significance and so on? And I've been examining those, and I'm going to be talking more about some of those this coming Wednesday night. And in connection with what we talked about this last Wednesday night. But I just want to say this. Jesus, when he was speaking to Nicodemus, he made a very blunt statement at one point. He said, we speak that which we know. And I believe that as Christians, that is vitally important for us. When we begin to talk about issues of salvation and Bible prophecy, topics that affect the eternal life of other people, that we need to make sure that we know what we're saying and that what we say is true. Because I've been looking at some of these things, and quite honestly, some of the things I've been looking at, they concern me because they're not well documented, and in fact, when you begin to study and to look at it, you find that some of it is actually just fraudulent. Some of the so-called documentation is actually fraudulent. It doesn't even exist in reality, or it's been much changed from the original. And so we want to get to the bottom of some of these things and understand what's being said out there and look at certain prophecies in Revelation 17 and see how they really do fit today or don't fit at least the interpretations, some of the interpretations that we have heard. Okay? Well, good morning again. Our topic today, for today though, is making a U-turn without driving in reverse. We're going to talk about making a U-turn without driving in reverse. If you have our slide presentation, we're going to go to number 2. And here we see some apples on the left. But on the right we see applesauce. Now, are they basically the same thing? Apples and applesauce? But they seem a lot different. It looks different. It has a different texture, a different consistency. It's went through a process and it's been converted. The apples have been converted from raw apples to applesauce. Isn't that right? They've been converted. They've been changed. There's been a change process. Now here we have, in slide number 3, water. I could have had a different picture, but this was a convenient picture of water. But just think about the concept of water. And in slide 4, we have salt. If we put them together, we get what? Salt water. That wasn't so hard. I'm not trying to trick you today. But then if we add some honey to it, we get sweet salt water, right? But then if we add some applesauce to it, we have some applesauce that's probably not going to taste too interesting, right? But you know what? If we add just 2 more things to it, if we were to add some flour and yeast to it, you know what we would get? We would get bread. That's right. We've taken all those different ingredients, we've combined them in such a way that we've converted them into bread. We have the monarch butterfly in its caterpillar stage on the left, and we have it on the right as a full monarch, and that's not the viceroy, that is the real monarch. And yet we could say that there's been quite a metamorphosis between these two occurred, right? Has occurred. And this caterpillar has changed, as it were, into a butterfly. It's been converted or changed. And the definition, if we go to slide number 10 of convert, it says it means to cause to change in form, character, or function. Production processes that convert raw material into useful forms, as an example. What we're talking about today in making a U-turn is talking about conversion. We want to talk about conversion. And true repentance results in a turning away from sin and having an inner renewal, which can only be brought about by God, who draws his people to himself, who through Jesus Christ gives forgiveness of sins and a new life. Now, conversion. We need to think about this thing called conversion. It is a turning to God, or a turning back to God. If we'd open our Bibles to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 30. It says, "When thou art in tribulation, and all these things come upon thee, even in the latter days." Would that have anything to do with us? Mm-hmm. "Even in the latter days. If thou turn to the Lord thy God, and shall be obedient unto his voice, for the Lord thy God is a merciful God. He will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee, nor forget the covenant of thy fathers, which he swore unto them." And so we have that promise in verse 31. If we do something, that's turn to the Lord. And he says that we can turn to him here, and he will hear us. Luke chapter 1, we have here a prophecy about John the Baptist. In verse 15, it says, "He shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. And he shall go before him in the power and spirit of Elias," or Elijah, "to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom and the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." He says he's going to turn people. In slide number 11, we have this Greek word, epistropho. Epistropho. And this is the Greek root word that's translated turn in these verses. And just to give you an idea of how this word is used, we have here a little chart that shows how this word is used in the New Testament. You see that about half the time it's translated as turn, turned, turning. But it's also translated about a fifth of the time as convert or converted, return, and several variations of that. And so this idea of being converted and turning are very synonymous with this word. In Luke chapter 22, in fact, we're going to see this word several times this morning as we begin here. Luke chapter 22 and verse 32. He says, "I have prayed for thee, that thy faith fail not. And when thou art turned..." Oh, it doesn't say that, does it? What does it say? Converted. But it's the same Greek word that we translate turn. "When thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren." And so we see that concept here. In Acts chapter 14, it helps us to understand what we turn from. Acts chapter 14, verse 15. This was Paul and Barnabas here, and it says that they heard about this adoration that they were receiving that wasn't right, and they said, "Sirs, why do you these things? We also are men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that ye should turn from these vanities unto the living God." He says you should turn, or you should repent, you should change. You've been going one direction, but I want you to go another direction. I want you to change. Move away from these vanities unto the living God. In 1 Samuel chapter 7, we go into the Old Testament. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 3. "And Samuel spake unto all the house of Israel, saying, If ye do return unto the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the strange gods and Ashtaroth from among you, and prepare your hearts unto the Lord, and serve him only, and he will deliver you out of the hand of the Philistines." And so they have been worshiping these idols and these gods, Ashtaroth and Baal. And he says, if you will turn, then God will hear and God will be with you. So we see this concept of turning. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. "For they themselves shew us of what manner of entering in we had unto you, and how ye turned to God from idols, to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivereth us from the wrath to come." Is there wrath coming? I'm going to tell you, friends, there's wrath like mankind has never known wrath, and it's coming. But we have the chance to be turned, to turn away from our idols, to turn away from our filth, to turn away from the things of this world, and to put our eyes, friends, instead of upon the things of the world, upon Jesus Christ. We can turn to Christ, and he will help us. And an example of the change this makes is found in Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter 19. Here we have a story of Paul working with the people in Ephesus. And some of those people had been involved in what we would today simply call witchcraft and the occult. And they had these books about curious arts and things. And in fact, in chapter 19, verse 18, it says, "And many that believed came and confessed and shewed their deeds. Many of them also which used curious arts brought their books together and burned them before all men, and they counted the price of them and found it to be 50,000 pieces of silver." And so these men at Ephesus, they took these books that they had, valuable books, books that were worth a lot of money, and they burned them. But they made a turn, and they weren't going to turn back. Have you ever heard the expression to burn your bridge, or you know, burn your bridges behind you so that you can't go back? It said Alexander sometimes as he would be marching out that they would burn the bridges behind them. He didn't want his men to think they were going back. As Christians, we need to burn our bridges and we need to turn away from sinful things. This concept is also clearly taught in the Hebrew Old Testament. 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 13. "Yet the Lord testified against Israel and against Judah by all the prophets and by all the seers, saying," notice what the message is, the message is, "turn. Turn ye from your evil ways and keep my commandments and my statutes according to all the law which I commanded your fathers and which I sent to you by my servants, the prophets. Notwithstanding, they would not hear, but hardened their necks like to the neck of their fathers and did not believe in the Lord their God." What a pity. And friends, if we would become stiff-necked and stubborn and not believe either, then God will have no choice but to allow that wrath, which we spoke of earlier, to come upon us. It will happen. But we can turn away from our sin today. In Isaiah chapter 55, in verse 6, he says this, "Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him," what? "Return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon." You know, when we talk about a Christian, or someone who's known the Lord before, we don't always have to say, let him turn to the Lord, because maybe if he's went away from the Lord, he'd been there at one time. And so we would use the expression, return. Return to me. You've been my people, but you've left me, now return unto me. And for those of us who have maybe known the Lord, maybe known him when we were a child, maybe even we were baptized as a child, but we've walked away, it's time to return. It's time to return today and to come back to the Lord where we belong. Going back to 2 Kings, if we could, in verse 11, it says, "He did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, and departed not from all the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel sin, but walked therein." It says, he departed not. In other words, he didn't turn. Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse 23. God says, "Have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, saith the Lord God, and not that he should return from his ways and live." God speaking to his people, he's speaking to us today to return. To return to a better place, a better position, to return to him because we've walked away and we've left him. True conversion is a change of heart, of thoughts, of purposes. Evil habits are to be given up. The sins of evil speaking, of jealousy, of disobedience are to be put away. A warfare must be waged against every evil trait of character. Let me pause there. That doesn't sound like a play fight, does it? It doesn't sound like we're getting sticks and plastic guns. It says a warfare, a real Christian warfare, and the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, right? But it says that we have a warfare, and it must be waged against how many of our evil traits of character? Every single one. Then the believing one can understandably take to himself the promise, "Ask and it shall be given you," Matthew 7:7. And that comes from Testimonies for the Church, written by Ellen White in Volume 6, page 95. And so if we want to claim that promise, "Ask and it shall be given," then we need to be able to honestly say that we have engaged in warfare against every character trait that is working against the truth about God. Now, conversion, I want to talk to you about conversion as a turning away from unbelief to faith. It's a changing, not only of from disobedience to obedience. But really the only way that can happen is if we turn from unbelief, from disbelief, toward faith. And that's what God wants. And in fact, this is linked with the concept of repentance. In Acts chapter 3, the text we're probably familiar with, Acts chapter 3 and verse 19, it says, "Repent ye therefore, and be what? Converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." Now it says here to repent. And this basic root word for repent is metanoel. And it means to change one's mind or purpose. In other words, to change your thinking. Before you can change the direction your body is going, friends, before you can change anything that happens outwardly, you have to change what's happening inwardly. You have to have a repentance. That means a change of thought. You must be converted, he says. And if we look in Ezekiel 14 in verse 6, it says, "Therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus saith the Lord God, repent and turn yourselves from your idols and turn away your faces from all your abominations." To repent and to turn go together. We can't truly repent, friends, without turning and making a change. If we say that we've repented, you know, people all the time, they tell me, "Oh, you know, I gave my heart to the Lord. I became a Christian last night. I went to the altar. I got saved." You've heard these kind of expressions, and sometimes people, friends, do that. And I'm so thankful anytime anyone really does give their heart to the Lord. But I want to tell you, friends, we never can give our hearts to the Lord without making a change. It just doesn't happen that way. Unless we have turned and we're following a different path, then we really haven't been converted, no matter what our profession is. In Ezekiel chapter 18, in verse 30, "Therefore I will judge you, O house of Israel, everyone according to his ways, saith the Lord God. Repent and turn." Repent and turn. "Repent and turn yourselves from all your transgressions, so iniquity shall not be your ruin." He says that if we don't change our ways, friends, then we haven't really become Christians. In Acts chapter 26, Paul is speaking here to King Agrippa, "Show first unto them at Damascus and in Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance." And in Acts chapter 11, in verse 21, it says, "The hand of the Lord was with them, with the believers, and a great number believed and turned to the Lord." Here you see they believed. Now, this word believed is the Greek word pistuo, which is the verb form of the Greek word pistis, which we translate as what?
Faith.
Faith. Right. And so they had faith. And because of their faith, they turned to the Lord. It happened. It made a difference. And conversion brings a new life. It does bring a change, friends, in our lives. The Bible says, if any man is in Christ, he is what? A new creature. Some translations say he's a new creation. But the only way you can be a new creature is to have a new creation. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, it says, "Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." And that renewing of the mind comes to that repentance, "that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." And if we could turn to Galatians chapter 6. See, we're new creatures in Christ. We're transformed, just like the caterpillar to the butterfly stage. In Galatians chapter 6, in verse 14, Paul says, "But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a," what? "New creature." See, we can be a new creature in Christ, and you can be a new creature in Christ too. It doesn't matter what your past has been, because, friends, Christ is greater than your sins. He's greater than our evil tendencies. He's greater than the habits that we have acquired through our indulgences or even through heredity. He is able to help us. Jacob Daniel Belshazzar. Anybody ever hear of this guy? Probably haven't. He was born on November 15th, 1912 and lived to 2008, lived a good, long, productive life. But you probably have heard of his boss. Colonel Doolittle, James Doolittle. And you remember what he was really most famous for? On April the 18th, 1942, they took 16 B-25 Mitchell bombers, specially loaded and prepared, and flew them off the end of aircraft carriers that had never been done before. To take a plane that big, they didn't have catapults in those days, and they somehow were able to take these planes off the carriers close enough to the island of Japan that they went in and did a bombing raid over Tokyo. They realized it wouldn't probably have a significant effect upon the war effort as far as destroying too much of Tokyo or disarming the Japanese. But at that time, we needed a shot in the arm because Pearl Harbor had happened not too long before this. And we needed to let the Japanese people know that somehow we were going to get in and we were going to get to them. And so they took off. And Jacob DeShazer was on the 16th plane that took off. He was the bombardier. And when he took off, he was an atheist. He believed in no God. But during the air attack, his plane was hit by enemy anti-aircraft flak, and he was forced to bail out. He was captured and imprisoned by the Japanese and thought certainly that his life was approaching an end. He saw two of his companions shot by a firing squad. He watched another one slowly die of starvation. And during the long months of imprisonment, he pondered the question of why the Japanese hated him so much, and why he hated them so much. It's said that on the morning of December 7th, 1941, when he learned about Pearl Harbor, that he just screamed out, "The Japanese are going to have to pay for this." But he began to think about these things, and he began to recall some of the things that he had heard about Christianity. So one day he got the courage to boldly ask his jailers if they would give him a Bible. An English Christian Bible. Well, at first they laughed. They thought it was a joke. And they grew ugly and they wanted him to stop making such a nuisance of himself. But you know, he kept asking. And a year and a half later, in May of 1944, a guard came in and threw a Bible into him. Said, "You can have this for 3 weeks." 3 weeks. He says, "And 3 weeks later, I'm going to come and I'm going to take it away from you." And true to his word, in 3 weeks the guard took the Bible away, and DeShazer never saw that Bible again. However, in those 3 weeks, he applied himself intensely, searching, meditating, and trying to understand the meaning of life and humanity's ultimate destiny. And a change came about. He made a turn. And later he was released from the Japanese captivity and he returned home. But before he was released, he gained a new appreciation for life, even the life of his captors. And he started to treat them with respect. He started to treat them with dignity. And you know what happened? They started to treat him a little better. They started to show him some dignity, too. Well, he went back home, and the war was over. And in 1948, DeShazer and his wife and infant son decided to go to Japan as missionaries. They went as missionaries. All because he asked for a Bible and a Japanese guard gave him one for 3 weeks, he searched the scriptures and he found the meaning of life and he made a turn. But you know, the good part is the story doesn't stop here. I don't know if you've ever seen a picture or have ever heard of Mitsu Fuchida, but in 1941, he was about 39 years old. In 1941, on December the 7th, he was at Pearl Harbor. He was leader of the squadron that bombed Pearl Harbor. And he was a very effective bomb leader, strike leader, and he was involved in several other important battles. But in 1950, he survived the war. He was at the Battle of Midway. He was injured. Survived the Battle of Midway. In fact, because of injuries, he was back in a desk job in 1945. And I believe it was on August the 5th, I didn't verify this date, but on August the 5th, he was in Hiroshima. and then got called away for something, and the next day, you know what happened in Hiroshima? Somehow God spared this man's life, because in 1950, he read a tract that the Shazzer had written entitled, I Was a Prisoner of Japan. And he read that tract and he became a Christian. And the Shazzer, who was in Japan at the time, working as a missionary, they got together, they became good friends. Jitsu became a missionary himself, a preacher, and they would often preach together and hold meetings together and encourage other people in Jesus Christ. Isn't that something? That's what the Bible can do for people, friends. That's what the Word of God, because the Word of God is powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And when we come to Jesus and we make that turnaround, God says, now there's something I want you to do. Because I want you to demonstrate to everybody else, not only through your life in everyday living, but through a very special service, I want you to demonstrate that you've made this change and make an acknowledgement of this commitment. We call that baptism. In Romans chapter 6, if we could turn there, verse 3, Paul says, know ye not that so many of us, as were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized unto his death. Therefore we are buried with him by what? Baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. The early Christians called baptism a sacramentum. Have you ever heard the term sacrament? They called it a sacramentum because it's from a Latin word that stood for the Roman soldier's oath of absolute devotion and obedience to his general. Did you know that? In other words, I'm making a solemn oath that now to my general, Jesus Christ. I'm making an oath of loyalty and obedience to him through baptism. Isn't that a beautiful thought? Isn't that wonderful that the Lord does that for us? Gives us that chance? But it demands, friends, a new lifestyle. In Hosea chapter 12, verse 6, he says, therefore turn thou to thy God, keep mercy and judgment, and wait on thy God continually. Not just the day you're baptized. Not just the moment you come to Jesus, but every day, day by day, you are to live for him. Just as Jacob the Shazzer read the Bible, he began to treat his Japanese captors with respect and dignity. We change, friends. The day that Jesus comes into our hearts, we change. And the Bible speaks in the 5th chapter of Galatians about the fruit of the Spirit that becomes part of our life. The love, the joy, the peace, the long-suffering, the gentleness, the goodness, the meekness, the faith, the temperance. All these things of which there is no law against. It becomes part of our experience. And the beautiful thing about this too is that it gives us a new status. It gives us a new status. Turn with me to Galatians chapter 4 and verse 7. We'll read verse 6 also. It says, and because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. And because we are sons, he says, this happens. And verse 7 now, wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And that word servant could also be translated slave. You're no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. And Paul says that we are heirs and we are joint heirs. We are equal heirs with Christ. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should what? Be called the sons of God. I don't have to be a son of Beelzebul anymore. I don't have to be a son of Budweiser anymore. I don't have to be a son of anything in this world anymore. I can be a son of God. I am an heir and a joint heir with Christ. And you know, one of the beautiful things is it just everything else becomes new. We get a new understanding. Not only does the world look brighter, more beautiful, the trees are greener, the songs of the birds are brighter, but we can understand spiritual things. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, starting in verse 12, he says, seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for until the day remaineth, the same veil untaken away, in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Verse 16. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. ESV version here on the screen for you. I'll just read those this way too. I like the way it says it. Since we have such hope, we are very bold. Not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not gaze at the outcome of what was being brought to an end. But their minds were hardened, For to this day, when they read the Old Covenant, that same veil remains unlifted, because only through Christ is it taken away. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts, but when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. And what Paul is saying simply is that when we read the Bible unconverted, we don't understand it. And we can understand, because spiritual things are spiritually discerned, and without the Spirit of God, we cannot understand these great truths. But he says when we have Jesus Christ, that veil is taken away, and we can now understand. What a blessing that we have as Christians. Now, at least we think that somehow we must bring conversion about to ourselves. We need to understand, friends, that conversion is a work of God. It's not the work that I can do, because I can't change my heart. I can't change my ways. In Jeremiah 24, God tells us to turn, but he tells us that he will help us to turn. He will be the one who actually turns us. In Jeremiah 24, and verse 7, he says, "And I will give them a heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God, for they shall return unto me with their whole heart." But it's that heart that he says that he has given them. A heart that is not a heart of stone, as it says in Ezekiel 36, but a heart of flesh. Now, if you remember, we go back to the second through eighth slides of our program. We don't have to look at them right now. But remember, we saw the apples and the applesauce. And then we saw the flour and the water and the honey and the salt and the yeast, and we had bread. But you know, if you take apples, you can make applesauce from it. That's a fairly simple process. We've known about that for a long time. But those are really not accurate illustrations of true biblical conversion as far as the soul. Something got converted there. Something got changed. But you see, they're changing using the same ingredients, just transforming that ingredient. But imagine if you had a rock. Can you take a rock and make a heart of flesh from it? You can't. You have to have some miraculous event occur, because rock just can't be converted in any physical way that we know of to become flesh. And we who are accustomed to doing evil cannot of ourselves in any way be made to do good. There has to be a miracle. There has to be a conversion, a new heart put within us. And this is a work of God. And so today, if you're thinking about this experience and you're wanting that experience for me, I want that experience today. But you're thinking, I don't know how I can do this. Don't worry, you can't. God says it's not important for you to worry about how to do this, because you can't do it anyhow. He says, you just open your heart and let me come in, and I will take your heart of stone, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And that's what he wants to do for each one of us. It's called the new birth experience. John chapter 6 and verse 44. Jesus says, "No man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day." And we know that God is drawing every person's world to Christ. And he does. And in John chapter 3, Jesus, when he was speaking to Nicodemus, in verse 5, he said, "Except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter in the kingdom of God." We have to be born of the water and of the Spirit. "That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again." Jesus is emphatic. This is an imperative. You must be born again, and you're not going to see the kingdom of God without this conversion experience, without turning around, without making this U-turn from destruction, away from destruction, to God. Jesus said in verse 8, "The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit." In the book Desire of Ages, on page 515, we are told, in working for the conversion of our children, and the principle we're going to read about here, friends, applies to children or to adults or anyone about how this happens. But it says, in working for the conversion of our children, we should not look for violent emotion as the essential evidence of conviction of sin. Nor is it necessary to know the exact time when they are converted. We should teach them to bring their sins to Jesus, asking his forgiveness and believing that he pardons and receives them as he received the children when he was personally on earth. That's Ellen White's writing in Desire of Ages, page 515. But friends, there's a prescription for every one of us, whether we're 2 or 92, right? Mm-hmm. It says simply that we are to come to Jesus just as we are, and we are to ask his forgiveness and believe that he pardons and receives us as his children. We become the sons of God. It's just that simple. Let's turn to James chapter 1, verse 17. The Bible says that every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Friends, is repentance a gift? It is. The Bible says repentance is a gift. And it's a good gift. And it comes from God. He gives it to us. Of his own will beget he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. And so he has done this for us. In 1 Peter chapter 1, and verse 23, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, how? By the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. This is a work that God wants to perform for us, but we have to cooperate with him. We have to turn our hearts over to him. We have to surrender to him. In Testimonies for the Church, volume 6, on page 22, we are told that for the conversion of one soul, we should tax our resources to the utmost. One soul, one to Christ, will flash heaven's light all around him, penetrating the moral darkness and saving other souls. The Apostle Paul, when he said, "Let us not be weary in well-doing," he wrote that for a reason, because he knew that it would be easy to become weary in well-doing. But friends, that's what our responsibility is to do. It's to tax our souls to the utmost, to try to work for souls. In volume 9 of the Testimonies, on page 189, it says that if we would humble ourselves before God and be kind and courteous and tender-hearted and pitiful, there would be 100 conversions to the truth where there now is only one. Have you ever heard of John Rowlands? Anybody ever hear of John Rowlands? You probably haven't heard of John. But John changed his name, and you probably heard of Henry Morton Stanley. Stanley, that's right. In 1871, the New York Herald sent Henry Stanley to Africa to look for a missionary. His name happened to be David Livingstone. And after an unbelievable amount of hardship, Stanley found the explorer in Central Africa, and he spent 4 months with him. And Stanley went to Africa as a conceited and a confirmed atheist. But the humble, gentle, pitiful attitude and life of Livingstone had an effect upon him. His gentleness, his genuineness, his goodness, his zeal, all of these won Stanley, and Stanley became a Christian. And Stanley later said, "I was converted by him, although he had not tried to do it." Just by simply that life. So as one turns from sin to God through faith and repentance, we become a new creature through Jesus Christ. And we begin to walk in the newness of life. And there's a change, friends. We have a change of status from a poor beggar to a son of the King. We make a U-turn. You know, there's a sign or two on the road. Sometimes you see these signs. You ever see a sign? Something like this, and it means what? No U-turn. I want to tell you, Satan works to prevent your conversion. He doesn't want you making that U-turn. But the Lord wants you to make that U-turn, friends. He wants you to make it today. And he is able to help you. 1 John 4:4, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. He's able to do it. He's the one who deals with conversion. He's the one who takes stony hearts, friends, and makes them hearts of flesh. I can take apples and I can put it through the grinder. I can make applesauce. But I'm not inherently changing the apple and just the way it tastes, its texture and form. But friends, when we are in Christ, we're a new creature because there's been a new creation. And that which was stony hard now becomes flesh, and that which was cold now becomes warm. And it happens as we turn our lives over to God, but it will never happen until we make that decision, that great decision, to turn our lives over to Jesus Christ. May God bless you to make that decision today and not delay. Thank you so much.